best-selling author, Dr. Gabor Maté. And founder of Choose Again, Diederik, Wolsak. Today's talk will be an exploration of how early environments influence the way we think, of how our mind creates our world. So Dharam Kaur, who is actually just right behind me here, who actually developed the Beyond Addiction program, will be guiding us through some extraordinary meditations from the Kundalini yoga tradition. So how's that for an amazing, elevated Friday night? I'm going to take a moment to talk a little bit about the Beyond Addiction program. It's an incredible life-changing program designed for people looking to develop healthy habits to overcome addictive behavior or understand addictive behavior. Now, the beauty of this program is that it supports the healing of the whole self. So the psychological aspects, the physical aspects, the spiritual aspects. So it does start in Vancouver on February 26th and runs until May. It takes place over 4 weekends during this time, 1 weekend per month. And it's jam-packed full of knowledge and techniques from breath, meditation, relaxation, self-reflection, Kundalini yoga. You'll get guidelines on lifestyle and dietary guidelines as well, stress management. I mean, there's hydrotherapy, naturopathic detox, nutritional and herbal guidance. You get access to an amazing community of people and wisdom from Dharam Kaur, Dr. Gabor Maté. So it really is an amazing program. We can all have an inspired and fulfilling life. It is possible. This program will definitely show you how. The program is internationally recognized as an effective treatment for addiction. And you may be wondering, so who's it for? It's for health professionals, counselors, therapists, psychologists, a perfect way to round out your toolbox. For yoga teachers who work with people with addiction, certified Kundalini yoga instructors who want to teach perhaps, you know, yoga-based addiction recovery programs. And of course, it's for those who are dealing with addiction. It's an amazing opportunity for you to get empowered. And it's for the people in your life who are dealing with addiction. So if you know of anyone, definitely let them know about this program. So to begin the night, Dharam will lead us through a beautiful meditation from the Kundalini yoga tradition. Thank you.
Thank you all for being here. First thing I'd like you to do is turn to your neighbor and introduce yourself to somebody you don't know. Good. Thank you. And now come back to your place. And we'll start with a breathing exercise that also incorporates movement. And this exercise is to balance your electromagnetic field and to integrate the hemispheres of the brain and help you release anything you've been holding on to from the day. So make your fingers into claws. Every second person stand up, otherwise you're going to be hitting each other. So every other person stand up. And stretch your arms out to the sides with your claws really tight, okay? Like you're going to scratch a chalkboard. Really tight claws. Arms out to the sides. This is the inhale. And then exhale, crisscross the wrists above the head, in and out through your nose. Inhale out, exhale, crisscross, but alternate what hand is on top. And now speed it up, beautiful. Inhale out, exhale, crisscross with a powerful breath in and out through your nose like this. Go as fast as you can and keep your fingers tight. Oh, that's amazing, amazing, awesome. 30 more seconds. You're beautiful. It's incredible. So this crisscrossing of the wrists is integrating the hemispheres of the brain. So your left and right hemisphere communicate better. Your intuitive side and your rational side are coexisting nicely. And the finger claws also activates a lot of the brain because the fingers activate a lot of the brain. So you're turning on your brain. It's a very good brain exercise. Now, last 30 seconds, open your mouth, stick out your tongue, and breathe through your mouth. And release all the guck from the day. Just let go of whatever you're holding on to. Good, good. Powerful exhales. Awesome. Now inhale the arms up to 60 degrees and tighten your fingers and hold the arms straight and hold the breath in. Consolidate the energy in your being. Feel your strength, your commitment to yourself. Keep the arms up, exhale through the nose. Once more, inhale, hold the breath, suspend. Tighten the fingers, let the arms shake, straighten your elbows, feel your strength. Feel your commitment to yourself, to your well-being, to your future, to your present. And exhale, relax your arms down. Good. Now come sitting down. Now we'll do another very simple breathing exercise. This also works on the hemispheres of the brain. And it helps us to be present with what is in the body, with it, what is in the environment. It helps us to connect because you'll be inhaling through the left nostril, which activates the right hemisphere of the brain, which is the part of the brain, the hemisphere that's more connected to the whole, the hemisphere that's more integrated with the synergy of things. And then you'll be blocking the other nostril and exhaling through the right. So you inhale left, use the little finger, block the left, and exhale through the right. Close your eyes, look between your eyebrows, and slow the breath down. Very slowly, breathe into the belly, expand the belly on the inhale. Straighten your spine, sit with a tall spine. And then take the breath all the way up to the top of the lungs. Exhale through the right nostril, drawing your navel in towards your spine as you complete your exhale. And be with the breath, merge with the breath. Hear it, feel it. This pranayama or breathing technique helps us let go of our story. It helps us disentangle or drop the identification with our story, and it brings us more into our presence, into our being. Just keep it slow. One more minute. Close your eyes. Look between your eyebrows. That focus between the eyebrows helps to center you. And pay attention to what you notice in the body. Keep slowing it down. And now deeply inhale through the left nostril, suspend the breath, just pause. In that pause, you can go into stillness, deep stillness, where the mind stops. And slowly exhale through the right. And relax your hand down. Sit quietly for a moment with your eyes closed. Be with yourself, be with your presence, be in this environment with all of us, simply existing together. And we call this meditation the meditation for a new start. Even just doing it 3 minutes a day creates an opportunity to start anew, to start fresh. Sat Nam. Now we'll have Dr. Gabor Maté and Diederik lead the way.
I thought introductions could be dispensed with because who you think we are doesn't make any difference anyway. I'll tell you why I'm working with Diederik tonight. Diederik runs a very powerful program in Costa Rica called Choose Again, which implies that you've already made a choice and now you can choose again. And I know that I disagree with Diederik about something or other, but I can't remember what. We're about to find out. That's the whole point. And so
sometimes, you know, I don't want to confess this, but I do look online to see what people are saying about me. it's rather interesting sometimes. The latest review, sometimes I look on Amazon.com, Amazon.ca, see what are people saying about the books that I've written, you know, and it's very interesting what people write. Somebody writes, as a book review, 1 star out of 5, this book arrived in a damaged package in poor condition. That's not a book review.
That's the package review. Who do you think you are, you know? And the most recent one, on the other hand, an Amazon.ca for my book on addiction, is a guy gave it 5 stars out of 5. And he said, my wife is a fan of this man. Happy wife, happy life. And that's his book review. I want to say, that's not a book review. That's a wife review. In any case, there's a couple of comments. I speak online at this conference called, or a video conference called Recovery 2. And somebody writes into Recovery 2 as a comment, and I had to just write this one down. Gabor Maté is the wisest, most grounded man I've ever listened to. There's just something so wise and centered about him. And I'm thinking, this guy has never seen me at an airline, Air Canada checkout counter, you know, where, when my flight is canceled or delayed or when I've lost my luggage again. But that's not what he would see at all. Somebody else writes, I used to like Maté in the 1990s, but it did something to turn me off. Forget what. We'll try to figure out what. So that's me and Diederik. I know I disagree with him about something, but I don't know exactly what it is. But I think that might emerge through the course of the evening. And incidentally, our plan is that I should speak for about 20 minutes or so, and 25, and Diederik, same thing. And then we'd like to turn much of it over to you for comments and questions and interactions, which is what we both enjoy very much. But I think what we both agree on is the message of a song I'd like to play for you now. And I do lead retreats and seminars sometimes, and invariably, I begin my sessions with this particular song. And I give this particular guarantee, and I give it to you tonight as well. If you hear this song, and if you totally get it, we can give you money back and you can go home and you'll have a perfectly powerful, happy, centered, grounded life. You don't have to listen to this Diederik and I talk. You don't have to come to the session tomorrow. You don't have to do anything. You just have to get what this song is saying. And the song is by my guru, Johnny Cash. And it's called In Your Mind. That's what the song is called. And you may not distinguish all the lyrics, but listen to the refrain. And I think Diederik and I will both agree that it all goes down in your mind.
Right.
So that he says, in your mind, it all goes down in your mind. 1 foot on Jacob's ladder, another in the fire. Jacob's ladder, of course, is the biblical ascent to heaven. 1 foot in the fire, of course, is hell. And you could be in heaven, and you could be in hell, and it all goes down in your mind. And whenever we think that it's because of the outside, we don't know who we are. We think that something's happening. So let me return to Air Canada with that in mind. So I'm arriving from Philadelphia back in June after a long series of flights and talking engagements and you know, seminars. And this one went really well. Standing ovation, people engaged, lots of questions, a lot of gratitude. And I'm coming home, and I was even upgraded to first class on the way back. I'm comfortable, you know, and I'm thinking, wow, I finally got it. My life is working. I understand it all. I can teach it all. Wonderful. This is who I think I am, you know, this guy who's got it. The plane lands, and I receive a text message from my wife, Ray, saying, who was supposed to pick me up at the airport. She's saying, sorry, I haven't at home yet. Do you still want me to come? So immediately, I'm seized by rage. And I send a very short court email saying, Kurt, text saying, never mind, or something like that. And I take a cab, and I come home, and when I come in, I'm barely even looking at her, and this aftermath lingers for about 2 days. This is despite the fact that I'd taken Diederik's workshop just 6 months earlier, where he taught some very useful techniques for dealing with just such situations. Yeah. So, who do I think I am? Well, 1 minute, I think I am this guy who really understands it. Finally, he's got it. You know, it's working. It's smooth. It's, you know, the road is now clear. The next minute, what am I angry about? The fact that I have to take a taxi home? I can't get into a taxi. At age 71, I can't get into a taxi and go home. I think I am a child being abandoned by my mother, and hence the rage of abandonment, of being let down. Now, I don't think that consciously. If I thought it consciously, that'd be no problem. Then I could say to myself, hey, I'm thinking I'm a baby again. But actually, I'm not actually a baby. That's an interesting thought, but I don't have to listen to it. So in this conversation that I'm having with you, when I say, who do I think I am, or who do we think we are, I'm not so much talking about the conscious thoughts that we have, but the unconscious beliefs underneath those thoughts. But those are thoughts as well, except they're not arising to the surface. If only they did. If only I could say to myself, my God, here I'm thinking I'm a baby again. But no, that doesn't happen. Instead, the emotion happens that the baby would feel on being abandoned, which is the tension, the anxiety, and then, of course, the anger. So the question, who do I think I am? If you ask most people, I once participated in a seminar in which there's the formal question, you know, who are you? And people say, I'm a soul waiting to be born. And that's the standard answer that's expected to be given. And, you know, there's truth in that. It's not that it's not true. It's only that, at least for me, and I'm not saying for the others who say that, I'm a soul waiting to be born, that might be really who they always think they are, and it just works for them to make that affirmation. I'm not putting it down. But for me, how it works for me is it doesn't matter how many times I say those things, that, you know, I'm a soul waiting to be born, or I am part of the divine expression of creation, or whatever I tell myself that may be true, something happens, and all of a sudden, who I think I am really shows up. In other words, the who I think I am is not fixed in stone. It's a process. It's an ongoing flow of beliefs that arise from somewhere, and it's based on those beliefs that we act or react. And that's why cash things, it all goes down in your mind. And it's what Buddha said as well, as, you know, with our thoughts we create the world. But as much as with our conscious thought we create the world, even more with our unconscious thoughts we create the world. And so how do you get at that? If it's unconscious, how do you get at it? And no amount of affirmations will ever, ever penetrate to the unconscious beliefs. That's why forms of therapy that, for the most part, address only what a person says or thinks about themselves, for me, are, as much as they may have value, they just don't get you far enough. They just don't go to the source, because the source is deeper than that. So that's easy to see in the case of other people. It's not so easy to see in the case of yourself. You know, take an obvious example, such as Donald Trump, who these days presents himself as a case study in separation from the self. If you ask him who he thinks he is, he will tell you that he's a successful businessman, a savvy negotiator, a confident speaker, just the kind of guy to lead the United States in this uncertain century. That's who he thinks he is on the conscious level. And he's fully confident that he's that person. But do something. Next time you see him or somebody else like him speak on the television, turn off the sound and look at his face. And then who are you going to see? You're going to see somebody who's puffed up, who's hiding from something, who's very angry about something that he doesn't know what it is, that actually he was quite scared. I remember being in Toronto when one of my books was being published. I was there for a speaking trip. You want me to speak up? Is that it? Okay. I remember being in Toronto back in 2004, I think, when my book, When the Body Says No, was published. And it was just on the eve of the bombing of, or 2003, I forget which year. It was on the eve of the bombing of Iraq by the Americans, just before the Iraq invasion began. And President George Bush was on television, sounding confident and convinced that this is the right thing to do and that we'll win and all this kind of stuff. And I actually did turn off the sound. And who did I see? I saw a guy whose brows were furrowed, who was completely uncertain about himself. I saw a scared little kid. So while on the conscious level, he may truly believe that he's the leader of the free world, which of course implies a whole set of assumptions. One is that there's a free world, and two, that he's the leader of it. But underneath it, there was nothing but fear. And you could see this in our previous prime minister. When I went around the country during the Harper era, which lasted way too long for the country's own good, I would ask people, what do you see in his eyes? And people would say, nothing. They'd say those eyes are empty. Well, why do eyes empty? Why does a person see nothing? Only for one reason. Because when they were vulnerable and helpless, they couldn't bear what they saw. That was a deeply traumatized man. But he didn't know that. And so when he saw vulnerability, he couldn't stand it. He had to attack it everywhere. Hence his aggression. Hence his hostility towards addicts. Hence his hostility towards native people. Anybody who's vulnerable. Veterans who were suffering from PTSD. He couldn't abide anyone who was vulnerable because he was so scared of his own vulnerability, because when he was vulnerable, he suffered so much. And we know something about the childhoods of these people. So I mention these politicians not to point fingers at them, but to give them as very clear examples of people who, on one level, they think they are something or somebody, but who they're being, who they're actually being, is reflective of a set of self-beliefs on a completely different level. And that's what I'm trying to get at here, is who do we think we are? And that question of who we think we are is the most important question. Well, I don't want to say that. I don't know what the most important question is. Who do I think I am when I say I know what I think? It's a very important question. And it's worth asking ourselves five times a day, every time we have an emotional reaction to something, it's worth asking, who do I think I am being at this very moment? So today I'm part of a, because of one of the retreats I led, people are have an email chain, so they write to each other, and somebody wrote to the group today saying that her mother, she was very happy about this, her mother said to her that all of a sudden that you don't have to carry the burden of worrying about my emotions anymore. That's quite a gift from a mother to an adult child, is, you know, let it go. I'll take care of myself. You know, because she's been doing it all her life, looking after her parents emotionally. And so people congratulated on her on having that burden lifted off her shoulders. But somebody else in the group wrote in a dissenting opinion. And this person said, actually, your mother can't lift that burden from your shoulders. Only you can lift it. Because as long as she's lifting the burden off your shoulders, you still think you're a small child who is at the effect of your mother, who is under the emotional influence of what your mother may want or not want. So it's great that your mother said that to you. It shows growth in your relationship and in your mom. But it's totally up to you to lift that burden off your shoulders, that automatic and compulsive emotional caretaking that you've done towards your parents all your life. So these self-beliefs that we have, I've already alluded to where they come from, and then, you know, in my case, I talked about, you know, it's the abandoned baby. That's my response when my wife is not there to pick me up at the airport. Now, I reviewed a book that was just published, and the review will be in the Globe and Mail tomorrow. And the book is called Wasted, and it's about this therapist who becomes a very severe alcoholic and really ruins his life, his family, his marriage, his practice. He ends up eating out of garbage bags in the downtown East Side. And then he has a very... It's a very gripping, vividly written book, and at the end he doesn't make it back, not to his family, but at least he establishes contact with them. He makes it back to himself. But he thinks that this is only because he was genetically programmed, because his father was an alcoholic, and so he becomes one. He doesn't quite see that the impact of his father's alcoholism and scenes like the father having sex with a strange woman in the house with the kids there watching while the mother is in the hospital, that this was somehow traumatizing for him. So the missing piece, extraordinarily, is always childhood. And this is where, you know, I don't know if Diederik and I will disagree on this, but my contention is that the concepts that we develop about ourselves, the underlying concepts, not the ones that we think and articulate and can be very eloquent about, But the one that actuate and activate how we're being and who we're being and how we're reacting and what we accept and what we don't accept and what we put up with and what we don't put up with. Those dynamics are set really early in life. They're set even in the uterus. Because we now know that and there's a movie, anybody saw the movie this week, In Utero? Anybody there? Okay, there was a premiere of a film at the Vancouver Film Festival Theater called In Utero, which I'm one of the people being interviewed in, so I was there for the opening of it on Sunday. And it's all about how already the parents' emotional states during pregnancy program the self-beliefs, the self-concept of the child. So, for example, if the mother is conflicted, on the one hand, she wants to be happy, she wants to have a baby, she loves the baby, she wants to be a mother, but on the other, she's in a stressful relationship. And those stresses are transmitted to the baby through the mother's nervous system and through the hormones, the chemicals, the stress chemicals that reach the baby through the placenta. They will already create a sense of confusion in the infant about, is this word a welcoming place where I can just relax and be myself? Or is it somehow dangerous and I have to kind of worry all the time about what kind of reception I will receive? So that already begins to happen in uterus. And although we don't have conscious memory, we can't possibly have conscious memory for that, we do have what's called implicit memory, which is embedded in our brain circuits. And the implicit memory is not for events, but actually it's for emotional states. And that conscious memory doesn't start to happen until we're much older. But the implicit memories of being welcomed or not, which is simply a reflection of how our parents felt when they were around us, those stay with us, and they shape how we see ourselves and what we believe about ourselves in the world. And the problem for the child, for all of us, is that the child doesn't just see how the parent is around him or her, but the child sees is how the parent is because of him or her. So children invariably and inevitably and automatically make it about themselves. That's called the narcissistic phase. There's nothing wrong with it. That's a healthy, natural state of development. But if in that phase, when you see everything is about yourself, then guess what? When the parents are unhappy, when they're stressed, when they can't look at you with fresh and loving eyes because they're too depressed or distracted, that's about you. So I am somebody who's not good enough. I am somebody who is not likable. I'm somebody who has to work to be accepted. Maybe I'm somebody who even has to put up with some bad stuff just to be accepted. And it's those beliefs that govern our lives. Now, how can we... By the way, let me pause here and recall something that I was going to start with, but I forgot, so I'm going to throw it in here. Which is, and I'm speaking to you now, whatever these words that I've uttered so far mean to you, however that resonates for you, who you really are also shows up in the fact that you're here tonight. Because if you're here tonight, it means, A, that you care about yourself. If you didn't care about yourself, why did you come? And if you're here tonight, it also means that you're somebody who believes, not all the time, but sufficiently, that there's truth in the world, and that perhaps you'll hear some of that truth tonight. And if you hear tonight, it also means that you believe somebody who, you believe you're somebody who can actually grow and benefit from experience and from information. Because if you didn't believe that, you weren't, wouldn't be either. So whatever my previous words have brought up for you, I do want you to take just one moment and acknowledge yourself for the positive thoughts about yourself, not about me, not about Diederik, not about this event, but the positive thoughts about yourself that actually brought you here. And you may have even thought that you came out of desperation, some of you, or out of curiosity, some of you, or because you wanted help, whatever you wanted. But underneath all that, all those things are true, that you care about yourself, that you believe there's truth in this world, and that you believe that you have possibilities of transformation and growth. So just take 3 seconds and acknowledge each of yourselves for that within yourself. That's also true. Now, to go on to my conclusion now, for now, before I pass the mic over to Diederik. So, this is not bad, this is just called humanity. This is what it means to be a human being. I mean, the Buddha said this 2,500 years ago, that with our thoughts we create the world. Why did he say it? Because people then already were suffering. And they were suffering because of what went down in the mind. So that's nothing wrong. But it's the reality that we all deal with. So then, what are some of the ways of coming out of it? Well, there are many ways, but surely one of them, absolutely necessary, is that whenever you're upset with somebody, whenever you've been through an experience that's painful, where you put yourself into that situation somehow, whenever you feel tension in your body about anything, my mantra is, whatever this tension, it needs attention. Those are always great times to ask yourself, when you've calmed down a little bit, when you can actually deal with it, to actually ask yourself, who did I think I was when that upset me? When so-and-so called me a name, who did I think I was if I got upset? How come I didn't see that it's just about them? It's not about me. Ah, the only reason I got upset is because what they said reflected something about I believe about myself. If it didn't, you wouldn't be upset. You would just see the other person as having a problem. So every time there's tension, every time there's upset, every time you're trying to understand why you did something, you know, there's two ways of asking that question. Why did you do that? There's the one way to do it, which is, why did you do that? It's not a question. It's an accusation. How could I have been so stupid? That's not a question. That's an accusation. People don't respond well when they're being accused, even if you're doing it to yourself. So when you ask yourself the question, who did you think you were, or why did you do that? In that accusatory tone, you're going to be hiding from yourself, because nobody wants to be accused, least of all by themselves. You're going to be in a defensive mode. Now, as the molecular biologist Bruce Lipton says so eloquently about the human cell, that the cell can be in defensive mode or growth mode, but not both at the same time. And the same thing is true about the human psyche, I would say. The same thing is true about the human psyche, and I could even go into the physiology of that, but I won't take the time now to do that. But when there's that accusatory, who do you think you are? Or why did you do that? There's a shutdown that happens. There's a defensive shutdown of yourself, psychically and physiologically. But if you can ask the question with compassionate curiosity, okay, who did I think I was when I did that? When I
reacted that way, when I allowed that, or when I didn't accept that, or whatever it was. Who did I actually think I was? Really, who was I at that moment? Now that, as soon as you allow that question, and you ask it compassionately towards yourself, the answer will arise, and you'll be able to see what had been hidden, and then you can even be grateful for the upset. You can even be grateful for the painful experience, because it came along to teach you who you really think you are, and thereby allowing yourself over time to grow and not have to stay in that trap that made you react, emote, or behave in that particular way. So in asking that question, who we think we are, there's a lot of potential for liberation. Now let's find out where Diederik and I disagree.
What he said. First of all, I'm incredibly grateful to be here. I'm incredibly grateful to Gabor for inviting me to be part of this. I'm incredibly grateful to be in the presence of at least one person, but I know a whole bunch of people in the audience, who are on the same page, who understand that who I think I am is not who I am. And that, for me, was an incredibly eye-opening realization that I had probably 18 years ago when I turned my life around from being a full-time drunk and drug addict to sitting up here with all of you and with Gabor in an amazingly healing and loving environment that could not have happened unless I had realized that who I thought I was not who I was. So the question, who am I, is an absolutely vital question. Ramana Maharshi, who you're probably all familiar with, will tell you that all you need to do is ask, who are you? And ask it over and over till there is no longer an answer. And when there is no answer, that's who you are. So all the examples that Gabor gave, which illustrate that the little as self runs the show, the little as self reacts, the little as self is in conflict, the little as self is sad, etc., that has absolutely nothing to do with who I am. The essence of my being, the essence of your being, is pure love, and nothing other than love. It's abstract, formless, infinite love. That's who I am. But because it's kind of hard to walk around this planet knowing that, because there's a lot of things I need to do on this planet, I also form a self that functions on the planet. The problem with that idea is that I formed that self from, as Gabor said, in utero for the first 5, 6, 7 years of my life. Things happen, people say things, sounds I made, parents behave in a certain way, other things happen. And all of those things relate back to me. Every single thing that happens at an early age is because of me. I have a good example of that. When my first daughter was born, I was in the delivery room, drunk. But when she was born, I was not too drunk to say to myself, that's the most incredibly beautiful thing I've ever seen. I'm going to stop drinking. But I didn't. So what do you think the message is that my daughter got? Subconsciously, yes, perhaps, but at a level consciously as well. I don't really believe in subconscious. I do believe in the fact that I make choices with incredible rapidity, which I then immediately forget that I made them. And that's what we then call the subconscious. So I simply don't remember. But I do remember making that decision that I was going to stop drinking for her, and I did not. Now, why did I not stop drinking? And Gabor just pointed out very, very eloquently and importantly that try to remove the why question from your mind, because it is an attack question. It is a question that leads only to, I did something wrong. Well, you can say, if you're a father and you have a newborn and you keep drinking, then you do something wrong. That's not an unreasonable inference to draw. However, I don't go there. I don't go to wrong. I go to what was that for? So rather than saying why, train my mind to say, what is this for, no matter what it is. So whether United Airlines loses our luggage, which it does with an incredible frequency, I'm not sure what their record is, I'd say it's about 40% of the time they lose the luggage. The question is, what is that for, not why? Never why is this happening to me. Why is this happening to me is a lethal victim position question, which I will not allow to enter into my mind. I will always say, what is this for? The other question about who is the I, and the fact that that's made up at such an early age, many, many years ago, probably, I don't know if my daughter was still there, but probably about 8 years ago at the center, it's been open for 10 years now. But there was a Sunday that absolutely everything was going wrong. We had some very severe cases, some very difficult individuals that required a lot of attention and that were not as committed to healing as one would think they would be by traveling all the way to Costa Rica. You think, well, you're really motivated, but the unfortunate truth is that people don't want to heal. And I'll leave that sort of in the air for now. Maybe we'll talk about that later, but that's certainly my experience. People don't want to heal. They want to keep the I that they made up, so the who do you think you are, that I they want to keep, and they want to get a different experience. The good news is that will never happen. As long as I want to keep that I, I'm going to get the same experience. It may look different. The form may change. Anyway, on this wonderful Sunday, everything went wrong, and I got a feeling that I simply was not familiar with. And that's unusual because I've done a lot of work, and all our work has to do with feeling. All our work has to do with feeling because the feeling takes me back to the I that I think I am. But in this particular case, I got a feeling that I had no idea where that came from. It was a devastating feeling. It was just horrible. So I decided to do a process on it, and we have a very interesting process, which we'll talk about it tomorrow and practice in depth. But that process takes me back to a belief. So it took me back to the belief that I should not have been born. Now, I had many clients that I've worked with over the years who had that belief. And I was always very curious about it because I honestly thought that's not one I have. I mean, I have all kinds of other wonderful, devastating beliefs, but that's one I didn't have. So I thought, I need to find out where this came from. So I went back into my process, into a deep meditation, and it came pretty well immediately. The message came from my mother. This was 1942. We lived on Java, Indonesia, in what was then called Batavia, is now called Jakarta. And the Japanese had just landed on Java, and my parents were fleeing into the mountains to escape from the Japanese. And my mother was 9 months pregnant. Guess what she was thinking? Not a great time to be pregnant. Guess who got that message? I should not have been born. There it was, crystal clear. And it's really important that we, as a growing healing community, which we definitely are, do not allow professionals, which are by far in the majority, to tell us that that is impossible. Please accept the fact that every belief you have, every opinion you hold, every thought you have is a repeat of something that you felt, thought, had an opinion on when you were anywhere from in utero to 4, 5, 6 years old. Do a little exercise for yourself. How many of you were in a slight conflict sometime today, a 24 hours period? Can I have every hand please goes up? Thank you. Now think back to that moment when you had that slight conflict, a little ripple, a little trigger. You were not quite enlightened at that moment. And then ask yourself, how old was I at that moment? And be honest. Because the good news is that I'm never, never, never upset now. The upset that I'm feeling is nothing other than a replay. And it's a replay of something I made up long ago. And here comes the good news. The purpose for the upset is to take me back to that belief. Do you get it? To get the circularity, so I'm upset. The upset is chosen by a belief because all feelings are chosen. Feelings don't happen. I choose the feelings I experience. So here's the feeling. Now, if I trained my mind sufficiently, I can take that feeling very quickly back to who is the I that chose that. Well, who is the I that chose that is not lovable, is not important. Ray won't pick my dear friend Gabor up from the airport. What does he think? He's not important. He doesn't matter. That's a natural, automatic reaction to the ego. But because Gabor is highly trained, he can immediately say, hang on a minute, that's insane. Like he said, can't I take a cab? Of course I can take a cab. So that's not the issue. The issue is that very quickly and very briefly, the idea that I don't matter was triggered. Does that make sense? Can you follow that? So any upset you have, it doesn't matter what it is, doesn't matter how big or how small or how huge, or whatever you think it is, it comes from a belief. And that belief is a contradiction to who you are. So the question is, who am I, is vital, because who am I is, as I said earlier, infinite, abstract love. As you can well imagine, within those words, infinite, abstract love, there's no room for anything other than infinite, abstract love. And therefore, if I'm experiencing something other than that, it's because I've made an interpretation. So I interpreted the situation. My wife doesn't pick me up. She sends me a little text. She's not picking me up at the airport. Now I'm going to interpret that. But who's going to interpret that? Not, how old are you? 72. Yeah. Jesus, you're old. Not the 72-year-old, but the 3-year-old interprets that, because that's who we go to for advice. So we automatically go back to the little self I made up, in my case 73 years ago, in Gabor's sense it's 72 years ago. That's how far back it goes, and that's how quickly it goes. So I go back and ask the 3-year-old, what do you think of this? Well, this is not a good thing. I'll tell you something else. People often think that in order to have... How many people here are addicts? Can I have a show of hands? All the hands should go up again, but they don't.
What's the question?
How many people here believe or think or know that they're addicts? Yeah, all the hands should go up. And if your hand didn't go up, it's either you're very tired or you're in denial. But it doesn't really matter. But what is an addict? An addict is someone who has repeated feelings that happen more or done 2 or 3 times a day. That is the addiction. And Gabor and I have spent many hours talking about these things, and I absolutely love sitting down with him. I can talk with you for a day without any trouble. 2-3 days would be a total joy. Because even when it seems that we don't agree, which does happen, because 2 egos come together, you're not going to agree, because you can't afford to agree, because otherwise your ego doesn't exist anymore, and we're not ready to do that. So we do disagree on occasion, but always when we sit and work through it and talk through it, we end up not disagreeing. And that is because it's not 2 3-year-olds sitting together. If it was 2 3-year-olds together, I would take a position, Gabor would take a position, and even if I secretly agree with him, I would go against that, which is what I used to do in my drinking days. I'd go to a cocktail party and I'd go in one corner and defend a wonderful philosophical position and win that argument, and then go to the other corner and take the opposite point and win that discussion as well. That was my 3-year-old in full flight. And the 3-year-old will run the show till I say no. But I have to say no. And I have to be firm, and I have to train my mind, and I have to be disciplined, and I have to develop vigilance, and I have to do what my friend is teaching, which is meditation, which is absolutely essential. What is the purpose of meditation to me? And it's purely to me, not to anyone else, perhaps. Purpose of meditation for me is to get a clear idea of what I'm actually thinking. So I can note my thoughts, I can see what I'm thinking, I can feel then the feeling associated with that feeling, and the purpose of the meditation is to be clear of that. So it's not a subconscious mess. It is not a war that's being fought without my being aware of it. I bring the war into my mind very clearly so I can then make what we call a choice. And then I can choose again. We're called choose again for a very specific reason. And that is because every single thing, every person, every circumstance, every situation in my life, I have chosen. Are you willing to take that 100% accountability? If you are, you're well on your way. I have chosen absolutely everything in my life, including Donald Trump, including George Bush. George Bush was a hell of a healer for me. It took, in those days, I still had TV. So when I turned on the TV, there was George Bush, and my stomach would turn, and I'd get nauseous, and I'd say, fuck this. But I had to find out what that was about, because that's what I'm about now. I'm not about rejecting anybody. I'm not about judging anybody, and I wanted to be right about judgment. I could give you a long list of judgments on Bush and Trump, but none of those matters. And why don't they matter? Because they're all about me. Every single judgment I have of George Bush is about me. Every judgment I have on Donald Trump is on me. And unless I'm willing to take that level of ownership, I can go around the planet and be really true and be absolutely right about my position and be convinced of my position, but it will never lead to healing. It will never lead to love. And I am on this planet to learn to love George Bush. I'm on this planet to learn to love Trump. Because what I'm doing is I'm falling in love with those aspects of myself that I call Donald Trump. But it's just an aspect of myself. It has nothing to do with Donald Trump. Does that make sense so far? Should we talk a little bit?
Yeah. So thank you. And very soon we will turn it over to you. First of all, the issues of, about this love business. It's interesting for me. I mean, I believe when you say it, that we are infinite love and...
Hang on a minute. I don't believe that in a second.
You don't believe it?
No. I stand immediately. I want to put a correction in that. I don't believe that for a second. I know it's true.
I didn't see. I know you know it, and I believe it. That's the difference. Okay. I just want to stake out my position here that if I know it, you know, on some level I must, but I don't know. Somehow I miss it a lot of the time. You know, that's the first thing to say. The second is to do with the matter of choice, and this is. It's an interesting word, choice. Now, to me, I get that what you and I are both advocating is that each person take absolute responsibility for themselves in each moment. So that if, you know, so I can ask myself, like when I was stuck in in Charleston, West Virginia, I think it was West Virginia, because there's a Charleston, where is there in Charleston? That's the other place. South Carolina, but the airline that issued a ticket from South Carolina was down in West Virginia, so therefore I had to stay at the airport for 6 hours. Well, I asked myself, why is this happening to me? Not to me, you know, I mean, the to me is the wrong part. Why is this happening is not a bad question. Why is it happening to me is the wrong question. Why is this happening? Well, it was an opportunity for me, for once, not to get upset. It's some airline agent who's actually doing her best to help me. And any hostility that I generate would simply make her day more miserable and impair her capacity to help me. So yeah, that's why it was happening, because I needed that teaching. I was okay with that. But it's the choice that I want to ask you about, Diederik, because choice to me implies consciousness. We both agree that this stuff happens early. So when I'm subjected to a certain set of difficult experiences, and we could all think of what they could be, what it has to do with personally being maltreated or finding yourself as an infant in a war zone or whatever, like Diederik did, whatever it is, and I did, whatever it is, what choice do I have at the moment when I conclude that I'm suffering because I am somehow deficient? There's no consciousness there. And to me, without consciousness, you can't talk about choice. So when you say choose again, I get it. It means that today I can choose. I can actually choose. Am I worthless? Am I insufficient? What I decided unconsciously way back then, before I had any words for it, I can choose again. I can see where that came from, and I don't have to be compelled by it anymore. But what is this choice that you keep insisting on happened in the first place? How can we choose when there's no awareness, there's no consciousness?
Yeah, I mean, the answer to that is you can't. However, this room is not full of two-year-olds. This room is full of people well over 14. And so when I finally got to the point where I was totally fed up with my life and I had a choice of either driving off the Sea to Sky Highway, I found a spot where there was no barrier and it would go down about 2,000 feet. There was no chance of a wheelchair at the bottom of it, or something had to change. And from that moment on, I became absolutely committed to no longer ignoring the thousands of thoughts that run through my mind, no longer taking anything for granted, no longer listening to a feeling and justifying the feeling. I do not want to justify an upset ever anymore. It doesn't matter what it is. I mean, all of us have situations in our lives. Every single one of us have situations in our lives where we all would agree that is a reasonable response. You are upset, and that makes perfect sense. What I don't want anymore, I don't want anybody to tell me anymore that I have a reason to be upset. Because if you do that, you put me back in jail. So I will never do that for you. I don't expect you to do that for me. We have a very simple exercise. We do a lot of work in a circle. And so somebody will come with a story, and the story will be incredibly upsetting to that person. And that person has made an interpretation of the situation, and that interpretation gives her the reason for the upset. And she's not budging from that. Then we go around the circle and we ask the other 12, 13, 14 people, is there another way of seeing this story? And then the original person can hear 12, 13, 14 different interpretations of the same situation. And what happens then is we make absolutely clear that all of those are also interpretations, but they were chosen by a different eye. So the original I chose one interpretation, which was devastating. The other interpretations came from a different I. And then what we make clear is that none of these are true. Not one of those interpretations is true. However, having done this little exercise, I now know that I can choose another interpretation. I have a really strong story about this, and Gabor knows this. It was a woman that came to see me about 14 years ago. And she had been sexually abused by her father, by her brothers, by her uncles, by simply every male in her early life had sexually abused her in horrific fashions. And she was suffering from a variety of cancers, and she was very, very, very upset. So she told me the story, and in the first session. The second session, she started telling me the story again, and I said, well, sooner or later, you and I have to understand that you telling me the story again is not going to get us out of it. So is there a way that we can cut through the story and go down to what's actually going on? And what we teach with sexually abused or any other abuse is that, yes, it did happen, but it happened to a body. And who am I cuts in right there at that point, because I am not the body. All my suffering, all the problems, every single problem on this planet comes from body identification. If you can think of one problem that does not come from body identification, let me know, but you can't. So I turned to this woman, because we were not making any progress with the spiritual approach that we use, and I said, can you say, my father's innocent and I love him? She exploded. She was absolutely furious. She said, haven't you heard a word of what I said? The fucker should rot in jail. Do you know what he did? And I said, yeah, I know what he did. Can you say my father is innocent and I love him? Same explosion. The third time I said, what would it cost you to say my father is innocent and I love him? And without missing a beat, she said, it would cost me myself. And I said, brilliant. That is the self you're defending. What you're defending here is the self you made up in the abuse, but that's not who you are. Who you are was not abused because who you are cannot be abused. Does that make sense? Who you are is infinitely above the battleground of abuse. And the minute you allow that to be true, the minute I allow that to be true, I can turn around absolutely every memory and reinterpret it and live that wonderful statement. I don't know who came out with it, but it's never too late to have a happy childhood. It's simply a matter of going back over and over, choosing a different interpretation. The interpretation is what I'm living. So the interpretation of being not being picked up at the airport is what my experience is. But the I that makes the interpretation is a false I. That I can be transformed, and that I has to be transformed if I want to have a different experience on the planet.
Okay, put that in your pipe and smoke it. No, I said, put that in your pipe and smoke it. Yeah. Strangely enough, even though I spend much of my working life dealing with trauma, I agree with you. And sometimes I even challenge people on the word abuse, because that's already a loaded word. And this is dangerous to say, and I'm going to put into context in a moment for you. But I might choose at some point to say to somebody, what if you didn't use the word abuse? What if you used the word, my father forced me to have sex with him? That's already different. That's just the real, that's what happened. That's the reality. What I want to say, and I'm not going to go into it anymore right now, and we're going to stop after my comment here and just take your questions. And if you want to argue with us, that's just fine. Because I understand how provoking this perspective may sound to many of you who really have endured a lot of bad stuff that was way beyond your capacity to handle when it happened. We're not dismissing that. All I would say is that before Diederik could say that to that woman, or before I could challenge somebody's interpretation of some very difficult experience, something has to happen. And if that something hadn't happened, you couldn't have said that. And what to have happened was not the intellectual content of what Diederik or I might say, but there had to be a relationship built up between you and that client, or between myself and whoever I'm speaking to, which just has so much safety and so much trust in it, that the person finds themselves able to let go of their defenses. So the brain reads safety unconsciously. Parts of our temporal lobe are probably reading how secure we are with a certain person, and not just even with a certain person, but with a certain person for one moment to the next. And when that safety isn't there, we go into that defensive mode. And what are we defending? That self. That self that we believe to be under attack. Now that same exercise that you describe where somebody tells a story and then you ask other people for their interpretations of it. I've done that too in my groups. It's interesting what happens. Some people take person A who tells the original story and have a certain interpretation of it. Let's say, I'm telling my story and my wife didn't pick me up at the airport, you know, and I showed that she didn't care about me at all, you know. That's me. And then somebody else might say, well, that's one interpretation, Another interpretation is that she's an artist and she's completely caught up in her painting, and painters never realize what the time is, which is a reality, you know. A third interpretation is that maybe she felt hurt because you've been away for so long and you spent so much of your time on the road. Maybe she just didn't feel like coming, and she, you know. All these are potential truly interpretations. What's interesting when I do this exercise, sometimes the person originally told the story will very gratefully receive these other interpretations, then they feel liberated because they can let go of that little self that Diederik mentioned. Great. It's not about me not mattering. It's something else entirely. But sometimes people will say, they get even more defended. And they say, you're invalidating my experience. You're making me wrong. So I'm just saying that this conversation has to be very delicate, and there has to be a tremendous sense of safety before we can go that deep to challenge people's sense of themselves. But yeah, we all hold on to ourselves, and then we defend the stories that the self has created in order to make sense of itself. And I think with that, where are the mics? Are the mics? The mics are portable ones. So if you have questions, just raise your hand and the mic will come to you. And we may respond by an answer. We may respond with a question. We may both respond. One of us may respond. Let's just see how it goes.
Hi. I'm really happy to see you both in the same room. Can you hear me? Okay. I was fortunate enough to spend a month in June at the center, Choose Again in Costa Rica, and I highly recommend anyone to do that. It's the nicest thing you can do for yourself. I've also been working for the Portland Hotel Society for 9 years. I was also fortunate enough to work with you during your last year there, Maté. And part of my homework after leaving the center in Costa Rica was to have a circle, host a circle for some of the clients in the Downtown East Side. And I've tried, however, it's, you know, it, like you just said, it is a very delicate matter because they have to, you know, they want to hold on to that story and be the victim. So I can't really keep their attention, and nobody wants to face that. I'm just wondering, from your take, the circle is the most therapeutic thing I've ever experienced in my 9 years. More than AA or the SMART program. But I'm just wondering if you think it is possible to work with some of the addicts and people suffering from mental health and addiction issues in a circle.
Well, I saw a YouTube, a TED talk the other day, and by a pianist, conductor called, I think it's Benjamin Zander. And without going into the details of it, he said, you have to leave people's eyes shining. And if their eyes are not shining, you have to ask yourself, who am I being that their eyes are not shining? So your question, you formulated it as if it was about the people in the Downtown East Side. It's not about them. It's about you.
It's always about me.
Yeah, I hate to tell you. So who are you being? So you need to ask yourself, I would suggest to you, you need to ask yourself, who are you being that you didn't leave their eyes shining? And I'm not going to engage with that conversation now. That's the kind of stuff we might do at the workshop tomorrow. But that would be my quick answer to that. Do you have another answer as well?
Yeah, I couldn't quite hear you. You said you started the circle and you invited people, and it didn't go anywhere.
I couldn't get through even the readings and then the 1 minute of meditation, and it's like, oh, I got to get out of here. I got to go meet someone. Like, people just couldn't sit
Wonderful. So you know what my response is. My response is, what is that for? Because the only thing that matters is how did you feel when that happened. And how you felt when that happened will tell you who the I was that started this circle. So what happened is simply these people came to you to show you where you are. And they brought you incredible healing. But the three-year-old says it shouldn't be like this. I'm inviting them to my birthday party and they're not playing with me. But they did exactly what you wanted them to do for you to realize once again, okay, this is the I that's showing up in this circle. Why are they not interested in me? Because I'm not interested in me. I'm not committed to my healing. Otherwise, I would recognize this is the best circle ever. All these people don't want to hear a word of what I have to say. What an incredible gift. Because the I that doesn't want to be heard now has an opportunity to be heard. Do you get that?
Yes.
That I is the I you made up. That I is the I that you have to heal. Nothing to do with the other people. I'm always really totally clear, and you know that, that the center is there exclusively for me. Everybody that comes to the center brings me something that I need to work on. And I've also said repeatedly, if the moment comes that I'm enlightened, which is now scheduled for 2842, at that point, I won't have a center. Gabor and I are teaching, and I'm speaking for him, and he may agree, he may not agree, but my hunch is he will agree. I am teaching what I need to learn every day of the week. I'm teaching what I need to learn. I repeat over and over and over again. Just a minute. I repeat over and over and over again what I need to learn. And I'm such a slow learner. You guys can probably get it tomorrow in one day. It has taken me 20 years, and I'm probably 2% on the way.
I was just going to say, I totally agree with you. I'm teaching what you need to learn, too. I just want to show you one little trick. You said you were trying, right? That word is a giveaway. I want you to try to stand up. No, you didn't try. You stood up. Sit down and try to stand up. Try to stand up.
I know this one. There's no try.
You can't. There's no such thing as trying.
I know.
As soon as you use that word, check in. Okay? Other questions?
I got a little stuck in my thinking when it seemed like you were questioning the idea of choice at a non-conscious level. And what's rattling around in there is we cannot not choose. Like even a single-celled organism responds to its environment in some way. Like if it's toxic, it tries to get away, and if it's hungry, that looks appetizing, it'll eat it, single cell. So we start off as a couple of cells and grow in utero, and habits are established. But those habits reflect a choice, even if we don't have something that observes it. And I think part of the learning, what you're talking about, is how do we develop the part that observes and begins to be responsible and claim the habits, and maybe, if we're lucky, change the habits. So that helped me kind of unstick about the idea of choice, and I just wanted to say it.
Okay, fair enough. And you know what? Everything you said about where that leaves us in the present, I totally agree with. And it's maybe just an argument about the interpretation of a certain word, which is maybe not worth pursuing too much. I only mean that for me, choice involves that there's an aware person there who sees a number of alternatives, and amongst those, he chooses one, or she chooses one. Now, the amoeba, when I poke it, has got no choice but to retract itself. It cannot say, well, I'll stick here with the pin, which should I do? So it's just how we interpret that word choice, that's all.
And for me, it becomes about the quality of awareness. And that.
I agree with you.
So we're refining.
I agree with you. And you know what? I think we should go into thank you. But rather than answering that, I think we should go to the next question, just because there's so many people with their hands up.
I had a, something on mind, but now speaking of choice, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, okay, I saw this. I interpret this as we make decisions, but they are not always made with a sense of choice. That's how it works for me. But I really just wanted to tell you that what I'm taking out tonight mostly, oh, it's so profound for me, is when you say, don't even use the word abuse. Just say, my father forced me to have sex. And I never thought of it before, but it just makes so much sense on so many levels not to use that word. First of all, when you say abuse, to me, it implies that for something to be abused, something is meant to be used. Like I can abuse my car by not putting oil in it, or my sofa by jumping on it. And that's why I think the word abuse is wrong on many levels. I really like that when you said, try not to use the word abused. And finally, I just wanted to ask Diederik, when you said, try not to say, don't say it happened to me, it happened to my body. What happens with emotional abuse? Did that happen to my body?
That's a very good question, and I would simply go back to what I said earlier, is that every feeling that I have is chosen by me based on my body identification. So emotional abuse still goes back to there is an I that can be emotionally abused or emotionally whatever, if we don't use the word abused anymore, but spoken to in a way that is harmful or hurtful. That can only happen to an identity that I made up. That cannot happen to who I am in truth. It never did happen to who I am in truth. But it did happen to who I thought I was, and I'm not who I think I am. That's the key to this whole talk, and to that, to really understand that it's impossible for me to be hurt by another. Physically, absolutely. Emotionally, no. I can only hurt myself. There's a wonderful little saying in this work, and that says it's my thoughts alone that cause me pain. It's my thoughts alone that cause me pain. Nothing else can do that. Nothing outside of me can do that. Now, I can invite people, and I have, to speak to me in a painful, what I experience as a painful or hurtful fashion. Absolutely. But I'm doing that in order to be right about a belief I made up a long time before they spoke to me. Does that make sense? So I have a partner, for example, who has an interesting habit of when I do something, she would say, I wouldn't have done it that way. Now, how many of you take that as I'm being made wrong? Can I have a show of hands, please? Thank you. I love collusion. It's a delicious game. We can all play it together. My training has to be to no longer see it as such, because what I'm hearing is my father's voice. My father never, ever, in his entire life that we shared for a period of time, ever gave me a compliment, ever said, you did that well. I remember we played sports, and one of the things that we had to do at home before we were allowed to go play was to rake the yard. Well, we had about half an acre, and raking half an acre of forest is a lot of work, but it had to be completely leaf-free. You'd think he was German, but he was Dutch. It had to be completely leaf-free by the time we're done. Guess what? My brother and I were excellent rakers. It took us about 2.5 hours, but there wouldn't be a speck of leaf anywhere to be found, and very proudly we'd walk into the house, and then my father would say, you held the rake the wrong way. You held the rake the wrong way. It's unbelievable that the level of potential for my little ego to be made wrong is huge. I remember I played many sports, and finally after back surgery, one second. Okay, we're going to other questions. That's what I was trying to say. So,
here's what I want to say about Diederik's answer. Had I been answering that question, I wouldn't have done it that way. You know, because and the only reason is that there's a lot of people with questions, and so I just want to keep our answers. I mean, I agree with everything you said, by the way. I just want to, okay. Whoever's handing out the mic, who's got the mic now? Go ahead.
Oh,
yeah.
Hi there. My name's Seth. Very grateful to be here tonight. You shared, I have a question. What are some ways to encourage those more loving beliefs or more constructive beliefs? When we ask the questions, what is this for? Or who do I think I am? When we come to some sort of answers to those questions, how do we encourage an alternative belief or an alternative self, as it were?
My quick answer is that you don't need to encourage any alternative self. That's already doing yourself harm. You're telling yourself that the self that you are is not good enough. It needs to change. My quick answer to your question is that just identify the false belief. That's all you got to do. And who you are will show up. So it's not a question of having to encourage anything. It's a question of just seeing through the veil of the story and the self that made up the story. Would you have anything else to add to that?
Yeah, my quick answer would be, how do you feel when you don't? So I can be right about a feeling, I can be right about an interpretation of a situation, but I don't feel good. That is my motivation. There's no other motivation needed for me. I don't feel good when I'm right. The saying is, you can be right or you can be happy. You can't be both. So if I'm right, there's a strong ego sense of satisfaction with that, but I'm not happy. So the motivation is absolutely within. I'm motivated to feel better and more joyful as time goes by. That's the motivation.
As a recovering alcoholic and a trauma-sensitive yoga teacher, my experience around Kundalini yoga when I was first recovering was very activating for me. And it made me actually feel like I wanted to drink or use drugs. I've been teaching trauma-sensitive yoga for addiction and mental health for about 6 years now, and I teach Hatha yoga. And I'm just wondering, and that was my personal experience, I'm wondering why this program has chosen Kundalini yoga, and I'm really interested in the program. So that's the question I have.
All right, so I'm going to turn the mic over to Seth. I'm not a yoga person. I don't do yoga.
Yeah.
I'm not going to go into why, I just don't. So it's not that the program chose Kundalini yoga, it's that the program chose me to participate in it, and because I love and trust Sataram, even though I find her yoga not something I'm going to do, that's what she does. So I'm going to let her answer the question.
The program uses Kundalini yoga because I practice Kundalini yoga and I created the program. And and over the almost 40 years that I've been practicing Kundalini yoga, I've seen hundreds of people who had addictions or limiting beliefs or trauma or pain totally transform with Kundalini yoga. Kundalini yoga can be very intense, and I agree with you that it can activate your stuff, but it's stuff we need to see. And with a safe container and a loving container, and with support and insight and self-reflection, it's a very fast track to healing addiction and to healing the separation we have from the source or from that infinite love, as Diederik calls it. So I personally love the Beyond Addiction program, partly because I put it together. I'll say that, but it also works. And this is the third time we're back here in Vancouver teaching it. And we wouldn't be here unless we were totally enthralled and inspired by the people that are going through it, who are becoming new people. So that's it. I appreciate your concern tremendously, and I think Kundalini yoga can be taught in a trauma-sensitive way, and that's what we're encouraging as we teach it. But it's also probably, in my limited experience about all forms of yoga, it's a form of yoga that occupies the whole self. So we're dealing with the breath, we're dealing with the body, we're dealing with the mind by using mantra or by observing our thoughts. And the completeness of it in terms of connecting with the self or connecting with sound or connecting with the breath easily gives us a break from identification with the personality, with the self we thought we created. And it also creates almost an immediate experience to that place of love, of infinite love. So at the same time, we're deconstructing the personality, we're creating the connection to that deep state of love within oneself and also in the safe environment that we create in the group. So thanks for the question. Satnam.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just want to say one little thing in addition to that. I have trouble hearing it because I'm very old. I'm even older than my friend. But I thought I heard you say that when you were doing Kundalini Yoga, the urge to use it came up again. Is that what you said? Then I would say Kundalini Yoga is working beautifully. Don't run from it. Go to where your discomfort is. Discomfort is aroused only to bring the need for correction to awareness. So if I'm only going to follow programs where I feel comfortable, where we hold hands and we sing Kumbaya and we give a lot of hugs, absolutely nothing is going to happen. But if you can get triggered by Kundalini Yoga to a desire to go use again, then that is absolutely fantastic. Welcome it. Run to it. Say, wow, that is where my healing is because I'm being triggered. Any trigger is an opportunity to heal. Don't avoid triggers. Don't avoid people that annoy you. Go to them. Go to them. Your healing is there. Okay?
With that, if there's anybody here whom we haven't annoyed or offended, we deeply we apologize. Okay? All right. Now, I know that there's a question here in the front here. Okay, you go ahead, and then we'll hand it here. And then go ahead, yeah.
I have a question about traumatic experiences. So when you have an emotional response to something, how can you pinpoint when it happened in your early ages?
Well, you don't necessarily need to pinpoint when it happened. But give me an instance, would you? Just as a quick demonstration, if you're willing to. Something that you can share, nothing drastic, dramatic, embarrassing, just some upset that you had recently.
I'm too shy.
Okay, all right. Never mind. Let me ask you, we don't even have to hear about it. Let me ask you this question. Never mind the incident that happened. Forget the story of what happened out there. How it felt inside your body. Was that familiar to you? Okay, how far can you trace back that familiarity?
Definitely back years, early childhood, for
sure. Early childhood, okay. Whether you recall this first incident that induced that feeling in you, or whether you don't recall it, really doesn't matter. Okay. All you gotta get is that what's happening here, as Diederik says, is a memory of early childhood.
Oh, okay.
It's not about the present. You get that feeling, and then your mind makes up an interpretation. I'm feeling this way because such and such. But actually, you're feeling this way because you've always felt that way.
I don't think I disagree, although it may sound like I will. It is, in my point, from my experience, absolutely essential to go back to the earliest memory that I can find, and then do the process at that moment, reinterpret that moment, go back to the moment with my eyes closed and say, how does it feel now? Okay, I'm feeling a lot more at peace with it now. Then go back again, because maybe there was two or three or four other beliefs that were formed at that moment. Go back to the incident again that came to your mind. Do the corrections again and see how do you feel now, till you're completely at peace with what happened, in your case, 12 years ago. That's absolutely essential from my point of view, because everything that happened from them is a replay of that moment. So if I can reinterpret that moment, all the others will fall into place. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah.
And also, it is our experience, and that's I would say 95% of the time, as soon as you're really in your feeling will take you back, because that's the purpose of the feeling. The feeling only has one purpose, and that's take me back to the identity made up, and when did I make it up? Okay, it's over there. That's when I made it up. My feeling will take me there. Does that make it? And to me, it is so important also to understand that people that have addictions or that have serious issues in their life, quote unquote, it doesn't have to come from a horrendous, traumatic childhood. In our experience, I would say 75 to 80% of the people that come to see us take that feeling back to a moment that my mother or my father was 5 minutes late picking me up from preschool. That's when I made up, I'm not lovable. That's how incredibly innocuous it may seem. And your ego will then actually beat you up and say, you have no right to be that upset about that, because it was only 5 minutes, or my wife was painting and therefore she didn't come pick me up. But it's almost always something really seemingly innocuous but huge to a child. Mm-hmm. It is an experience of life and death. If my mom or my dad is not there when they're supposed to be there, I am threatened. My life is threatened. That becomes a traumatic incident. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So it doesn't have to be huge. It doesn't have to be, I could go on. I'm not going on.
Hello, thank you for sharing your words of wisdom and all the deep thinking around addiction and the self. And my question or comment is around my daughter who's dealing with addiction, but also other people in my community, and I work and live in an Indigenous community where there's a lot of trauma and a lot of addiction, and I'm a recovered or recovering addiction. I don't think of myself as an addicted person still. I actually have a philosophy around that, but I'm careful what I tell myself, and I realize I'm telling a new story. And so when I think about love and how to help my daughter or other people in the community who I see their children suffering in families who are dealing with addictions, I think about how do we hold the space to help that child tell another story? Because I hear Dr. Gabor Maté talk about, you know, how the child picks up in utero this story, and how close we are because we love them so much and we're so connected and we're all one, right? In my Sequatma worldview, we're all one, we're all related. So if we're all related, there's a tension, a real learning tension for me in trying to hold the space and help people is where do I end and they begin when they're my daughter and when they inherited the story from me, because I look at them and I see that deeply. But I've got to be careful of my own projecting my story. And so I guess it's just trying to figure out, like, how do I, on my own journey of self-realization and healing, hold this space in a way that helps them to tell a new story, their own story. But especially children, like really young children too, because they've inherited this memory and it's so deep, and it's just sometimes hard, because sometimes I've noticed when I've shifted my own energy non-locally, I don't even have to be in the same room or the same town with them, I see a change. And sometimes that's all I can do.
Yeah, but you just answered your own question.
Yeah.
You just answered your own question. I don't have to say anything more about it personally.
Okay.
Okay?
So thank you for affirming that.
And any time.
I'm curious on your opinion or experiences with the relation to depression, addiction, with physiological illness, for example, parasite, gut issues, the gut-brain connection, inflammation, that realm. I'm curious.
So your question is, how does a physical illness, like having parasites, have an impact on...
on mental health, the connection there, and your experiences helping and treating people. I understand, you know, our psyche and our ego, but also how our physical body affects our brain as an organ.
Yeah, the brain, of course, is connected to the gut. You mentioned the gut, parasites.
Yes, know? Yes.
The brain is connected to the gut,
mm-hmm.
Mostly by means of a nerve called the vagus nerve, which is very much under the influence of emotional states. That's why we talk about things like, you make me sick to my stomach, mm-hmm. or scared shitless,
mm-hmm.
or pain in the ass, or any number of physical states to do with the gut that are mediated by the vagus nerve based on the emotional states. But the vagus doesn't just carry messages from the brain to the gut, it carries many more messages from the gut to the brain. So the gut actually has been called the second brain, because it's a sensory organ as well as an immune organ, as well as an emotionally processing organ. Mm-hmm. And so that when things go wrong in the gut, of course it'll have a powerful effect on the brain. Mm-hmm. And some imbalance in the gut will very often show up as imbalance in the brain itself. Mm-hmm. So there's a powerful two-way communication. I'm sensing that Satyaram wants to say something here, is that right? Well, come on up.
It's also now understood that, you know, we have about 500 different species of organisms in the small and large intestine. Some of those organisms are more pathogenic, some of them are very friendly. There's 10 times more bacteria in your gut than there are cells in your body, so whose home is it, you know? Who do we think we are? but certain of those bacteria, through the vagus nerve, create inflammation in the brain. Where there's inflammation in the brain, there's more depression and anxiety. So you have to fix the gut to fix the brain. And we now know there's certain species of lactobacillus or bifidobacterium, like certain strains that actually decrease anxiety and depression. Who knew? And so you can replace those good bacteria, which we have in the Beyond Addiction program, we talk about that as well. Replace those good bacteria and you reduce some of the anxiety and depression. So you always have to heal the gut to heal the brain. You gotta do that first. Many people with addictions also are full of candida, candidiasis, overgrowth of yeast. So if you crave sugar, if you've been an alcoholic, you have a yeast problem, you have a candida problem. Your brain won't work well, period, until you clear the yeast or the systemic candidiasis out of your system. So those are part of the healing process. And we want to have 3 bowel movements a day. We want to have 45 grams of fiber a day. We got to get rid of the shit physically as well as emotionally, and they go well together.
Thank you.
I would like to throw perhaps a non-physical response to that, and that is, I used to have stenosis, and my good friend the doctor knows what that is. Stenosis is a narrowing of a bone channel through which the nerve runs, and it pinches and pinches, and it gets worse till you can't walk anymore. And at one point, about two years ago, it was crippling. It was so painful that I couldn't be in the circle. So I went down to my room and laid on my bed, but the pain was unbearable. I couldn't lie on the bed. So I went outside and sat in my rocking chair. And then I asked, without knowing why, who's the I that's in pain? And with that question, the pain was gone, completely gone. Now, I'm not enlightened. If I were enlightened, I would simply ask that question and not experience the pain anymore as suffering. Last year, I got in a cab, and the taxi driver was from the Punjab, and I asked him, how was your day? And he said, oh, not so good, sir. And I said, well, why not? And he said, well, I didn't sleep very well, and I have a really bad headache. So I said, do you want to keep that headache? And he turned around as if I was from Mars, and he said, of course not. And I said, are you willing to try a little exercise? And he said, yes, I am. I said, ask yourself, who is the I that has a headache? And he went like that. He said, how did you do that? I didn't do anything. See, it's the, like I said earlier, it's the body identification that causes the suffering. Health is inner peace. So I can be completely healthy and riddled with cancer. Because health is inner peace. It's my interpretation of what's happening that causes the suffering, not the body. Does that make sense? And that's a stretch for a lot of people. But I've had enough pain, I've passed 2 kidney stones with that question, who's the eye that's passing the stone? No pain, and I passed it. Well, before I was hospitalized with kidney stones, screaming. But that is an incredibly important question to ask under any circumstances. Who's the eye that's having this experience? Because if it's not a joyful experience, it's not the I that I am. Does that make sense? So that's really an approach that we use very strongly, who is the I? And that's really the subject of this conversation.
Why do you keep asking if it makes sense?
Because if it doesn't make sense, I'm clearly not expressing myself clearly, and I'm highly invested. In that I finally get it. So if you don't get it, I'm not getting it either. So I need to be very clear. Does that make sense? Yep.
Hi there.
Okay. Next, yeah.
There we go.
Where are you? Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you very much for both speaking. My recent more conscientious awareness of these types of issues, of watching some videos online and stuff of your talks, brought me more awareness to the importance of being parents to children under the age of 7. I have 2 young boys, 5 and 4. At what age can I start fostering some type of awareness in them of these types of issues? So where are...
What types of issues?
Well, the connection between the formative years up until 7 and how it affects them later in life or as they're growing through them. I mean,
why would you want them to why would you want them to understand that?
Because I'm aware of it now, and I'm trying to be more aware how it affects me as an adult so that I can be a better parent to them, I guess.
Well, how about you don't worry about what ideas to knock into their heads, whether they're true or not. How about giving them an environment in which they can stay connected to themselves so they don't have to figure out what you had to figure out at your age?
Well, I think my parents thought the same thing when they were
raising me. Well, I don't know what they thought.
Yeah.
But did their parents work on themselves like you're working yourself right now?
I'm sure that's the answer, yeah.
Yeah. So the thing is to be the person in whose presence those kids can connect to themselves and stay connected.
That's becoming harder and harder these days. Yeah.
Well, that has to do with what we both said to the person who asked the question about the circle, about who you're being right in the moment. So I would say at this point, your main task as a father, and it's not a task that I carried out very well when my kids were that age, but your main task as a father is just to be so safe for them that they never have to disconnect from themselves. And to manifest so much love in their presence that they know that the universe is love. And you don't have to worry about then, about what they will know and what not, they won't know later on about the early formative stuff. If, on the other hand, later on they start asking those questions, that's the time to start giving them the answers, but not before.
Thank you.
I would add to that, it's you teach by demonstration. So the more at peace I am, the more aware I am, I'm not in the fortunate position to have 4 or 5-year-olds, but I wouldn't worry about it at all. I would just do my own work. I have a little story about that. It was a couple that came to see me. They were very close to divorcing, absolutely hated each other, couldn't stand each other. The first 2 sessions, 3 sessions went really well. They really understood that their happiness did not depend on their partner. that they were entirely 100% responsible for the relationship, each individually for their relationship, because it's with themselves. The third session, the fourth session, they asked if they could bring their 4 and 5 year old boys. Well, these were little hells on wheels. They didn't pay any attention. They ran around the room. They were doing somersaults. They were hitting each other. It was a somewhat chaotic session, to put it euphemistically. They went home. The father had got in the habit of meditating, and he was sitting meditating. It was very blissful and very peaceful. And the little five-year-old had a brilliant idea to blow up a paper bag. He blew up the paper bag, went next to his daddy, and went, boom, and his father exploded and sent him to his room. The next morning, the little boy comes down. One session of listening or not listening came down and said, Daddy, when you were upset last night, that wasn't about me. Kids know. So if I do my work, the kids will know. I don't have to worry about it. If I can take the word you out of my vocabulary, when I talk to kids, when I talk to my partner, when I talk to anybody, and only talk about the self, I will be heard. The minute I say you to either my partner or kids or anybody else, the door closes. Nobody wants to hear it. They want to hear who you are at that moment. Who am I? That's what they're vitally interested in. They're not interested in me telling them how they should be. They couldn't care less because I'm not demonstrating it. But if I demonstrate it, they'll be interested. The same thing with that circle story. If I demonstrate it, people will come to the circle. Absolutely. Does that make sense? I thought I'd put it in for you.
Okay. Who's got the mic now? Go ahead.
First, thank you to both of you. First, to Gabor, I accept your apology.
Okay. Right. I didn't upset you?
That's right. Okay. Or annoy me.
Sorry to hear that.
That's on you. So we've been talking about how negative emotions trigger implicit memories, right?
I don't know that either of us would use the word negative, by the way.
We'll use
whole feeling.
Any trigger or upset you said today,
yeah,
right?
Okay, yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah. How does that apply to positive emotions? Can you have a positive emotion and be completely present, or do positive emotions also trigger implicit?
Well, the first question to you is, who's judging whether an emotion is positive or negative? Who's making that evaluation? Who's putting value mm-hmm. on some emotions and placing a negative interpretation, if you like, on other emotions? So who's doing that?
That's a good point. So if we take sort of the value out of it, a pleasurable experience, or if we call it joy, you have the present moment experience of joy. Does that mean that that's an implicit memory of a childhood experience? Or can it be purely present?
Well, the teachers make a distinction. They don't call joy an emotion. Right. They call it a state of being. And they say it's an essential aspect of who you are. So when you're experiencing true joy, you're experiencing yourself. Now, you may have experienced it before, but the experience is you in the present.
Thank you.
I'm hoping I can get a little dose of reality from the two of you. You seem feisty enough, and I need your guidance. I am a big believer in the power of compassion and how far that can reach. And my education, I'm not an academic. My experience and my education comes from way too many years on the street and in the shelters, and finally through recovery and feeling the compassion from others. I have to deliver a talk in front of a TEDx audience with my big lofty ideas about compassion. And I wanted to know your feelings on if the general public felt that addicted citizens deserved treatment, then and we were treating an addicted person with more compassion, do you think the government would provide more opportunities for treatment?
Well, I wonder if you happen to see an op-ed I wrote for the Vancouver Sun this last Monday.
No, not yet.
Look for it online, okay? You can find it.
Okay.
And it had to do with a study done by an academic at Simon Fraser University who found that they looked at a certain number of addicted people on the downtown east side, and after a number of years, a lot of expense, a lot of treatment programs, so on, their legal status didn't improve, and their health didn't improve, and you know, what are we spending all this money on? And this question of how to solve the problem of the downtown east side keeps coming up. And it's based on a fundamental misconception, which is that there is the problem of the addict or the problem of the downtown east side. The problem is that of the whole country and the whole culture, which generates a lot of pain, a lot of hurt for people, and some people escape from that pain through addiction, which is what addictions are all about. So my mantra on addiction, and some of you would have heard it, is never why the addiction, but why the pain. And that's what you have to help people understand. When people get that, unless they're too closed to their own pain, so they don't want to go to that place of vulnerability, they actually feel grateful because they want to be compassionate. They just don't know how to be compassionate because they see these people breaking the law and all this kind of stuff. Once they understand that it's about pain, a lot of people open with compassion. And as to how the government is influenceable, well, the previous government was completely impervious to fact, to documentation, to emotional pleas, to anything, that they would just rigidly refuse to show any program that showed compassion and sensible treatment. They wanted to shut down. The current government, I'm very grateful, is taking a different attitude. So the current health minister last week visited the injection site on Hastings, which the previous government did its best to shut down. So yes, the more you can convey the truth that addictions are not about bad habits, they're not about conscious choices, I would say, but they're about the choices people are driven to when they're suffering more pain than they can bear, that really opens up compassion for a lot of people. So I would suggest that you fashion your talk around those lines.
Continue.
Assume that your listeners want to be compassionate. Assume that your listeners want to love. Assume that your listeners want to help. And as just one final comment, more than you said you spent too many years on the street. No, you didn't.
I think it was just enough because it gave me the best education I could have.
You spent as many years there as you needed to, not one second less or more.
Thank you.
Hi. First of all, thanks. My question is, basically, I'm kind of in like a transition period right now where I've completed a treatment program. And this overwhelming feeling comes like I'm doing good and I'm all okay, it's gonna be good. I got this, my ducks in a row and okay. And then I just start getting these overwhelming feelings why are you doing this? You're just setting yourself up so that then when you relapse, you know, you're just gonna feel worse about it all. And these sabotage thoughts of like, this is all just a big setup for when I do relapse, go back to my real life, and then look back at it and feel like crap about all these good things that I did for myself, all these things that I could do, but why did I do it? Just so I can feel worse in the end? So my question is, what do you have to say about these overwhelming thoughts that come about when I start getting successful and start feeling like authentic again?
Fantastic question. The overwhelming feelings when I'm becoming successful, and I define success very simply as a state of being, a state of joy. That is success. my ego, the ego, which is the self that I am not, but the self that tells me that that's who I am, cannot live in that state. So the ego is going to fight back. And you may have noticed, when you have, and we've certainly noticed that at the center over and over, when somebody has a really good day, we tell them, be aware, because tomorrow your ego is going to come up with stuff you haven't even thought of yet. It's going to come from behind you and hit you in the back of the neck. It's going to do all kinds of wonderful things. That's good news, because that means the fact that you're hearing these voices that attack you to tell you why you're really doing this, you're going to fail anyway, that's the voice you need to hear in order to heal that self. Do you get that? So yeah. The self that you are now working on or working towards, which is the true self, which is the capital S self, would never think of drinking or doing drugs or doing stupid stuff like that. But the self that hates itself is not finished with you yet. So it's going to come back up again, and it's going to put up a hell of a fight, because you're threatening the very existence of the identity you made up.
Yeah.
And that's not going to go easy. I've never seen an ego say, okay, you win. I now know your love, I give up. It's not going to happen. So that little self that I made up is so full of self-hatred that it's going to do everything it can to sabotage my process. And you have to be aware of that. And you have to learn to listen and say, who is the I that just said that? Is that truly who I am? And the answer is no, that's not who I am. But that's the I made up. That's the I that always fell, that always failed, that always fell down again after thinking that I was getting up. But I'm not listening to that self anymore. I have to learn to listen to the true self. And the true self will not speak unless I ask. But I have to learn to ask. So my little self comes in and says, you're going to fail again. Watch what you're doing. This is just a setup. You've always failed, right? How many treatments have you been to? Dozens. You will fail again. Okay, wonderful. You say, I hear that. Now I want to hear from the loving self. What does my loving self say? And my loving self says, oh, honey, you've never failed. Everything you've done has been for you. Everything that's happened has been for you. And all I need to do is listen to that voice and accept that truth, and then I know that it's for me, and then all I have to do is live according to that voice. But that's the choose again that we're talking about. I hear this voice, or I can say thank you. That I've heard for 73 years. You're a total piece of shit. Yes, I know. Thank you. I'm fully aware of it. However, there's a part of me that knows that that is not true. That part has to be brought up. That part has to be educated. That part has to be acknowledged and made more and more obvious within my experience. Cool?
Thank you.
Doable?
Thank you. Yep.
Are you worth it?
Yes.
It's the only question. Are
yes.
you worth it?
Yes.
Then you will.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So that, yeah. That will be the last, that will have been. That was the last question and answer of the evening. Those of you that wish to participate in a workshop tomorrow, you can talk to people about that. It'll be this, working with people in greater depth. Other than that, before I pass the mic on to Sadaram, I will just thank you, thank Diederik. We've never worked together before, by the way. It's wonderful to do so. Thank you very much. it's not work. No, it's not. You're right. So thank you all, and here's Sitaram.
Thank you, Gabor and Diederik. It's a delight to be with both of you. We're going to finish with a very short meditation that will kind of integrate much of what we've talked about. It uses a mantra. The mantra is Sat Nam. Sat means being, essence, or truth. So that sound itself connects you to your truth, to your essence, to your being, instead of to the story, to the I that you think you are, that you made up. And Nam means identity. So we're saying, I am that, instead of the personality that we've made up. And so we also, from a yogic perspective, our behaviors come from various energy centers called the chakras. And the energy centers then govern the physiology and they govern our habits. So we have different habits encoded in these energy centers, these chakras. We have different addictions that come from different chakras. So one of the things we can do is to take that mantra Sat Nam, which connects us to our essence, and let it project from each of the chakras. And the sound itself acts like a clearinghouse for the patterns that are embedded in the subtle body, affecting the physical body, affecting our emotions, affecting our behaviors in those chakras. So this is a simple meditation that's used to change habits through sound and through vibrating that sound systematically and intentionally at each of these energy centers. So let's just go through the energy centers. First one is at the base of the spine. Second one is the sex organs. Third is the navel. Fourth is the heart. Fifth is the throat. And the sixth, where we're gonna, the sixth is the third eye point, and the seventh is the top of the head. So we'll pulse the sound in six pulses of the sut, and the seventh pulse will be the top of the head. And this is like a bath, you know, a clearing bath, a cleansing bath with sound for yourself, so you can reshape your identity through sound. So I'll do, bring your palms flat together. This is a posture of neutrality in front of the heart center. And I'll do the first one, and then you join me. We'll do it for a couple minutes after that, okay? And as you chant the sound, imagine the sound is vibrating in each of those centers, starting at the bottom and ending at the top of the head on the Nam. Okay. Sa. Inhale and join me. Sat Nam. Through the nose. Hold that breath. Exhale through the nose, relax your hands down, sit in stillness, be. And gently inhale. And exhale. Thank you. Sat Nam.